Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care.
Welcome to St. Mark's, all of you here in the Faith Worship Center at St. Mark's, as well as those of you online. I'm Phyllis Hubler, a lay leader here at St. Mark's, having successfully completed the MicroMDiv program. And if you have any questions about what that is, it's through the Master's Institute in Minnesota, and it is thoroughly described on the website for St. Mark's. This morning, if you happen to see someone near you that you don't recognize or you haven't met before, this would be a wonderful morning to just introduce yourselves, and there's coffee and donuts in the fellowship hall. We'd love to have you invite somebody with you to get to know each other better. Let's stand now and sing the first hymn. We begin our service in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us join now in a moment of silence as we consider the ways that we have sinned against God and against other people. Let us pray together now, acknowledging our sin and turning to God for forgiveness. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. May Almighty God strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ might live in your hearts through faith. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we have celebrated with joy the festival of our Lord's resurrection. Graciously help us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and do, through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the choir's first.
Thank you. Please stand for the singing of our Alleluia verse.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, Alleluia.
Christ is risen.
He is risen
indeed. Alleluia. What do you do with that if you're one of the soldiers at the tomb after he's risen? Well, the Gospel of Matthew tells us what happens. And so this comes from the last chapter of Matthew. And it says this: while the women who were there at the tomb were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say, 'His disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep.' If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed, and this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." The end. That's how Matthew closes. This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. And if that's how Matthew closes, it must mean that it's pretty important to go and make disciples. And so we have that mission to this very day as a church. And we have that mission together with all Christians, believers, to enlarge the kingdom. And so we have a special guest here today, the honorary sainted Dr. Mike Bradley. He's not really that honorary sainted guy, but I just made that up, because he is the leader of our denomination. We're part of the Lutheran Church. Lutheran Church is a mission for Christ. Will you give him a warm welcome?
Thanks, Paul. Good morning, everybody.
Well, honorary and sainted, that's probably, that's something, isn't it?
If it was true, it would be something, yeah.
Mike comes all the way from Arizona to us, where it was, what temperature?
It was just under 100 when I left, so.
Yeah, so we're just cooling you off a little bit here.
That's right.
I've asked Mike to be here. Actually, we were hoping that Mike could join us back in October, but then you fell ill, so
we're
glad that you could come back here today. We're talking about enlarging the kingdom, and being part of the LCMC is a really important part of who we are. And so we're gonna do something fun with Mike. We're gonna do a fast quiz, if you guys remember fast quizzes from COVID time and things like that. So we're gonna put him through the ringer this morning.
Oh boy.
But before we get there, let's just do a little introduction.
Sure.
Tell us about your faith and ministry journey. What gets you excited every morning to serve?
Well, again, good morning. It's good to be back in Iowa. I was born in Glenwood, just south of Council Bluffs, so it's good to be back home. A little bit about me. I'm married to one wife, Debbie, for 45 years. We have 5 kids, 4 boys and a girl, and we have 6 grandchildren. The 6th is due to be born in about 2 weeks. So 3 boys and 3 girls. I grew up latter part of middle school and high school in Omaha, Nebraska. So I'm sorry, I'm a Nebraska Cornhusker football fan. I apologize. Oh, I see. Yeah, one. after high school, I served in the United States Air Force for 4 years when we had that little police action in Vietnam going on. And that's where my faith came alive. It was in the Air Force when 2 guys shared their faith with me. It began just in them building a friendship with me. And in the context of that friendship, they'd share about Jesus and his effect in their lives and the way they prayed. And one thing led to another, and the Lord just drew me to faith in Jesus. I came home to Omaha after my first 4 years and got involved in the Christian bookstore business. So some of you may remember from days gone by the Zondervan Family Bookstores, and I served as a manager and regional manager for them. And I was volunteering working with youth. So I was kind of Bailey before Bailey was Bailey. And a Lutheran pastor came to me. And I had little or no church background growing up, so I wasn't born into the Lutheran tribe. And he came and said, I think you might have a gift for ministry in the church. Would you pray about it? My wife and I did pray. Along the way, by the way, I married his daughter. And
that's a common theme. Last week, we had one of our missionaries here, and he came to our youth group because of a girl.
Well, there you go. Evangelism.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and it seemed clear that God was saying, this is the call I have on your life. So Debbie and I said yes to that call. Over the years, I've served as a youth pastor, worship leader, associate pastor, senior pastor. And then I had the privilege of being the president of the Master's Institute for 10 years, served a smaller church network, and then received this call to serve LCMC in August of 2020. And one last thing about me, along the way, as a youth pastor, I also coached high school basketball for boys and girls in high school baseball. The basketball thing is in my heritage. My mom, some of you will remember this, my mom was an all-conference guard in Iowa when the women played 3-on-3, half court. My mom was one of the defensive guards, and recently I had to chuckle when I called her, and she said, I've been watching the NCAA Women's Championships, and that Caitlin Clark, she's something else. I don't think I could even shut her down. The thing that gets me excited, I've talked with Pastor Paul about this a little bit. When I pray for us in LCMC, I see a picture of our association, by the way, of almost 1,000 churches here in the United States and in 15 countries overseas. I see God bringing us together as an association in love, and love for one another, and love for people who don't yet know Jesus as Savior and Lord. And just think what God can do through 1,000 churches. 1,000 churches who are empowered by the Holy Spirit. How many millions of people might God draw to faith in Jesus as Savior and Lord? How many millions of people might he fill with the power of his Spirit? How many millions might he give boldness to go out and to share our faith and to grow in lives of discipleship and serving? That's the thing that gets me excited.
Yeah, that's awesome. This is Mike's first time at St. Mark's. And so for y'all to get to know him a little bit more, we're going to do a little fast quiz.
Okay.
All right. So he's going to get 10 questions.
Okay.
Now, this is how it works, Mike.
Okay.
You answer and then you hit the buzzer. People get this wrong all the time. You don't hit the buzzer and answer.
Okay.
You answer and hit the buzzer. It does not count if you do it the other way around.
All right. Okay.
All right. So we're going to ask 10 questions. These are pretty simple, not too difficult. Is everybody ready? Can I get an amen? Okay, we're ready. All right.
Okay.
Here we go. Number one, cats or dogs?
Dogs.
Very good. You did that correctly. Very good. Number two, cookies or pie?
Cookies.
Number three, favorite pizza?
Pepperoni.
That's good. That's straightforward. Number four, mountains or oceans?
Oh, mountains.
Yeah, there you go. Number five, what would you ask Jesus when you meet him in heaven?
Why wasn't I born 6'5"?
Wait a second. You want your mother to have birthed you at 6'5"?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
All right. Okay. All right. Okay. That's all right. Number six, chocolate or fruity candy?
Oh, chocolate.
Number seven, favorite season of the year?
Summer.
Number eight, favorite book of the Bible?
Luke.
That's a good one. That's a good one. Why? That's not a question. Like, it's just,
yeah.
Why Luke?
For one thing, it has my favorite It's tough to say a favorite passage in Scripture. There's a lot of good stuff in Scripture, right? But the story of the prodigal son is my absolute favorite. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Very good. Okay. 9 and 10. Here we go.
Okay.
Number 9, TV shows or movies?
TV shows.
Favorite TV show? You have one?
MASH.
What's that? I'm just kidding. All right. Sorry. Couldn't help myself. Last one, color of your wife's eyes.
Blue.
Very good. Give him a round of applause for making it through fast quiz. All right, man. I tell you what, there are a lot of people that sweat bullets on that. You were perfect.
I got stumped on the pizza because I don't eat pizza.
Oh, well, there
usually
you go.
Anymore.
Yeah.
But when I did it, yeah, it was pepperoni.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll do some more serious questions here, although we have a couple silly ones here. So you've been what's called the service coordinator.
Correct.
Which we really need to change that name.
We do.
something else. I mean, I think it was like president, but whatever. He's the top dog in the LCMC. Give us your vision for where we're headed.
Yeah, the vision, actually going back to that prayer that I pray often in my little prayer room at home, the vision of seeing us coming together as one in love for one another. I mean, the Lord says in the Gospel of John, by your love, they will know you're my disciples. So I pray that that vision might become reality and that might enable us to participate in God's work in the world in drawing millions to faith in Jesus and empowering millions by the Holy Spirit to go and enlarge his kingdom. So.
It's not complicated. You've also written a book about safe places and talk to us about safe places.
Well, one of the things I think I'm called to do is help facilitate some further cultural development in LCMC. And one of the things I always notice about Jesus in Scripture and I love about him is people seem to be drawn to him. Sinners are, New Living Translation at the beginning of the gospel, or at chapter 15 in Luke, says the notorious sinners were drawn to Jesus. So there's like the regular sinners, and then there's sinners like you and I who are notorious sinners, and they seem to be drawn to Jesus, and they seem to be comfortable in his presence. The only people who seemed to have a hard time with Jesus were the bishops and the seminary presidents and so forth, you know, the Pharisees and Sadducees. And being a safe place is simply learning from the life of Jesus how to love people so they can be impacted by his love and his power. And as we do that, as we are that safe place, empowered by the Holy Spirit to be that safe place, God can use us to tear down a negative stereotype that's out there in our culture of you and I, that Christians, you're arrogant and angry. You're hypocritical and judgmental. And when people have that stereotype, they're not gonna be reasoned out of it. Usually it's gonna take meeting you or meeting me, meeting that Christian who's not that, and that's being a safe place.
Yeah. I'm gonna just jump to a question here because I think kind of leads into this. What do you see as the biggest obstacles for congregations, you know, in the next few decades?
Yeah, there are two or three things that I think of often. One is let us be on guard about being infected by the disease of polarization that's out in our culture. It doesn't seem like we can have a dialogue anymore so often in our culture because we're polarized. We demonize each other rather than sitting down and having a conversation. And if we're not careful, the culture is going to disciple you and I instead of us discipling the culture. So we need to be on guard against that. I think another thing we need to be on guard against is relegating the Holy Spirit to only an intellectual or a creedal belief. You know, we confess, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life. Well, that's fine and good, but unless there's an experiential aspect to our relationship with him, we're going to be robbed of power. We need not only Jesus' message, we need his power. So.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. We don't confess. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life. That would be the Nicene Creed. We only do the Apostles' Creed here. Amen? That's a church pastor joke. Okay. That's why that one did not fly.
I got it.
I'm going to reintroduce the Nicene Creed. You guys ready for that? Wow. All right. Let's get to something fun here.
You bet.
Mike, share with us two truths and a lie, and we'll see if the congregation can figure out which
one's
the lie.
Number one, I met and worked with Mother Teresa in Calcutta, India. Number two, I served in illegal house churches in Cuba. And number three, I played guitar in the rock band The American Revolution.
All right, think through that for just like 2 seconds here. How many of you think that number one is a lie? Raise your hand. Working with Mother Teresa. Well, you guys think, wow. You're really holy, you know?
I guess, I guess.
Number two, working with illegal churches in Cuba. Okay, how about number three, rock band? What? Wow. Wow, apparently. It's got to be the hair.
There used to be hair, but after raising 5 kids and being a youth pastor for 22 years, this is what happens. So don't tell Bailey I said that, by the way.
So which one is the lie?
Okay, it's number three, although I played in the American Revolution, but I played drums.
Played drums. So very good for those of you who got number three. Congratulations. Good job. All right. We're talking about working with others to enlarge the kingdom.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's our theme. What are you looking for from larger congregations like St. Mark's in partnering in the mission of LCMC?
You bet. First of all, I want to make sure that we as LCMC aren't forgetting St. Mark's or other larger congregations, that we aren't just taking you for granted, or that we're just coming to you when perhaps the association needs something. So I want to make sure we're paying attention to how can we serve and love Pastor Paul and the rest of the team here and your lay leaders. And we have some initiatives we've launched that hopefully will do that. But when you do ask, how might the larger congregations in their unique ways serve the association? One of the things is to just share who you are and to share your resources, people resources, ministry resources. That might include some things like a dream to establish satellite campuses, or sharing your online services with that 20 or 30 member congregation who can't afford a pastor anymore. And so how do they get that preaching resource for Sunday morning services? Maybe they establish a relationship with a larger congregation and they handle the pastoral care in their congregation and that kind of thing, but their sermon for the day might be one piped in from St. Mark's. Another way is some of our larger congregations are interested, in addition to establishing satellite campuses, planting churches and building relationships with other smaller congregations in their surrounding region. You've done that, for instance, already in Fairfield, Iowa, where you have Jason Christensen, who's down there, who, by the way, I heard play guitar the other night.
He's amazing.
Oh, my goodness. I told him if he would play guitar like that on Sunday morning, I would attend his church. But those are just some of the ways that I think larger congregations such as yourself could serve others in this region and across the country. But again, I want to make sure we're also seeking ways that we can serve you.
Yep. Well, we have limited time, so we're going to run through a couple of things here, because this is the most important question. If you had to choose a mascot for the LCMC, what would it be? Now, you got to understand, you're in Iowa,
okay.
So you've got a couple choices that are really good.
I'm going to go a third way, I think. And Debbie and I have a 6-year-old white Labrador named Maggie May. So guess what music I listened to when I was growing up? I would choose Maggie because she's joy personified. when she's chasing her tennis ball, she's just having so much fun. And I want to see that kind of joy represented in and through us as association. Secondly, she's focused. Nothing distracts her from going after that ball. I want nothing to distract us from enlarging the kingdom and going after that mission God's given us. And thirdly, she's love personified. And again, I think that's the thing that will win the day as people experience being loved through us.
So LCMC Labradors.
Yes.
That is actually the best explanation I have heard from anybody asking about a mascot. Don't you think that was great? Thoroughly thought through. Labrador. I'm down with it. Let's do it. We'll get you a shirt.
Okay.
With that.
Okay.
All right. Finally, you said your favorite passage is, you know, the prodigal son.
Yeah.
How does that help you connect faith and life every day?
One of the ways it constantly is connecting me to faith and life is the picture of the father in the story. Because of that picture of who God is that we have in the person of the father, I have no doubt that I have and that you have a good father in heaven who's absolutely determined to be good to us. And especially in the moments when you and I think we don't deserve it, when we know we don't deserve it, that father is still determined to be good to you and me.
Yep. Yeah, that's awesome. Well, we have an Iowa gift for you. We know that you live in Arizona,
okay,
but you were born here.
Yes.
And raised here. And so we just like, you can open this up because these are Iowa things. And I'll take the colors.
Okay.
That's
okay.
Perfect. All right. What do we have here?
All right. Some Iowa popcorn, which I love, by the way, popcorn. So we have a cutting. My wife and I both will love this, a cutting and serving board, which we can use. We love to have a little cheese with our adult beverage from time to time. And so is this a journal, I'm assuming, from Iowa?
That's awesome.
And I do journal, by the way, so I can make use of that. This is perfect. Sea salt caramels. Sea salt caramel is my absolute favorite. I don't know how you all knew that.
Everybody's getting hungry.
Okay. And then white paper. Yay. Let's see what we have here. Here it comes.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, a manna syrup, corn cob syrup. Love it.
There
perfect.
We go. There we
Thank
go.
You. These
well,
are great.
We're so thankful that you joined us today, and I just want to pray for you and
Thanks,
your
brother.
Leadership. And let's give him a round of applause here, and then we'll pray.
Thanks.
All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for today. What an awesome day where we can gather together and hear your word, sing your praises, and we get to welcome Mike here and just know that we're united. We are larger because you've joined us as part of the LCMC. And so we thank you for Mike being here. We pray for his leadership, God. I pray that you would just give him wisdom and that humility to be that service coordinator. God, I pray that as he works with the board and as we're kind of looking at where you're leading us now, LCMC 3.0, I pray that your spirit be working through those conversations and really leading and guiding us in all that we do. So Lord, we pray for his safe travels as he visits other congregations around the area and as he heads home. And we just give you praise for us being able to be a part of a larger movement of churches, Lord. We pray this all in Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, thanks for being here. And look, all this goodies that you're going to take home with you, I hope it makes it through the screening.
I hope it does, too. Thanks, Paul.
Too.
Thanks, everybody. So,
I'd like to invite you to stand now as we continue to worship the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Please remain standing as able as we repeat the words of the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. And the right hand of the Father, he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's pray now together. Gracious God, thank you for your beautiful world that in Iowa is currently turning green, sprouting spring flowers and dropping rain and sometimes still a bit of snow onto our fields and into our streams. Protect and sustain those that work in our fields and raise the grain and fruits and vegetables and livestock that feed us. In this land of such bounty, may none go hungry. Be merciful to the river communities on our state borders that are facing near record flooding in the next few weeks. Preserve life and property as they work to sandbag and meet the coming challenge that northern snow melt will bring. Lord, you are a God of justice. You are also a God of grace. Walk with us today at 2 as we join in unity with others, seeking to highlight your love for all, including those who have served their time of incarceration and are trying with your help to transform their lives, gain meaningful employment, and become community partners. Raise up more men and women to serve as spiritual mentors and accountability partners to those working toward this goal. God of mercy and healing, comfort the sad, strengthen the suffering, heal the ill, and be ever present to the lonely. Bless our teachers and families as the end of the school year approaches. May all those weary from life's busy schedules find time for peaceful quietude, that minds and bodies are renewed, and spaces for contemplating your word and spending quality time with loved ones can expand. Finally, Lord, embolden us as we share our faith journeys with others. Give us your words so we are clear in telling where our joy, our hope, and strength come from, so that your kingdom continues to expand, not in spite of us, but in partnership with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us now join together in saying the Lord's Prayer. Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
We want to just acknowledge one last thing here this morning. I'd like to invite Pam Schultz, our executive director, to come forward, and any staff members who are here at this time. So Pam has the opportunity to go on sabbatical starting tomorrow. And so she will be on sabbatical until June 15th-ish.
July.
See, that's what I really want. June sounds better to me, but July 19th, yes. And so, you know, we are all in fear and trepidation because what Pam does is she basically runs all the things behind the scenes at the church. So the church council is praying for the rest of us. Is that not true?
Yes.
Yes, that's true. But we're so happy that Pam gets to do this. I can tell you that I was able to go on a sabbatical many years ago, and it is so life-giving to people in ministry because you pour out all the time. And so sabbatical allows you just to spend some time away and rejuvenate and things like that. So what we'd like to do is we'd like to send Pam off with a prayer. And if you just want to extend your hands toward her, that'd be great. And we're going to lay our hands on her and pray for a wonderful sabbatical. Let's pray. God, we give you so much thanks for our sister Pam and all that she does for our congregation. We are totally blessed to have her as our executive director. God, you work through her in so many different ways, and we're just amazed by that. And so now, Lord, we're going to go it alone for a while she rejuvenates, while she rests, while she does some writing, while she does some travel. And all of those things, God, we pray that you would just enliven her spirit, that she would feel your presence, that she would feel your power. God, that she would find that rest, that peace that only comes from you during this time. And Lord, I pray that she also just knows how much we love her and look forward to her returning when she's done with her sabbatical. And so, Lord, our benediction that we usually say here, I pray this over Pam. As you go on your way, may God go with you. May God go before you to show you the way, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, and within you to give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We give her a round of applause. Thanks for all you do, Pam. Now let's stand and sing our closing hymn.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.